Enchanté.
Bonjour.
Très bien.
Ashley.
Enchanté.
Très bien.
Enchanté.
Bonjour.
Fabien.
Je vais vous dire.
Hi.
So can we start by asking what time is it at this point?
1:30. Est-ce que on se fait sonner par qui?
Vos instructions en français ou en
So, each team has 24 minutes to present this case to the judge. The time of the presentation will be divided as following. The first 12 minutes of the presentation are considered as being protected, meaning that the judges cannot interrupt the team. The next 10 minutes are not protected. The beginning of this period will be when I ring the bell, and when the non-protected period will end, I will ring it again, so it's going to sound like this. The judges have the possibility to of interrupting the presentation in order to ask questions of clarification on the subject presented at this moment. The judge will have to limit himself to 15 seconds to ask his question. The team has to answer the question, but can then continue his presentation without waiting for the agreement of the judge. The judges cannot ask questions on a subject having already been covered or which has not been presented yet. These questions must be approached during the period of question at the end of the presentation. The last 2 minutes of the presentation are meant to conclude the presentation and are a shield from questions from the judges. I will show boards showing the remaining time when there will be 12 minutes, 7 minutes, 2 minutes and 30 seconds left. I will make the countdown of the last 10 seconds using my hand. Period of question of maximum duration of 5 minutes is assigned to the jury at the end of the presentation. I would like to remind to the judge that it's mandatory to ask at least one question during this period. I will now invite the judges to introduce themselves.
Okay. So I'll start.
Mm-hmm.
Bonjour, mon nom est Fabien Paquette. Je suis directeur de l'unité d'affaires des vaccins chez Pfizer.
Good morning and good luck. Ashley Coughlin, National Business Director at Vaccines and Pfizer.
Good morning. Cynthia DeLillo, Commercial Director for the Oncology Business Unit.
Good morning. I'm Rhonda Gallagher, and I'm Vice President of Corporate Affairs for Pfizer in Canada. And good luck.
Je suis certaine que plusieurs d'entre vous avaient des frères et sœurs. Personnellement, je suis la sœur de deux grands frères avec qui je me chicanais toujours quand j'étais petite pour savoir qui va faire les tâches ménagères. Alors que on aurait été beaucoup plus productifs à se mettre ensemble pour le faire en une fraction du temps. Bonjour à tous. Bonjour à tous. C'est un plaisir d'être avec vous ce matin. Je suis ici aujourd'hui avec mes collègues Alain Mollet et Rebecca Sarro. Je suis Audrey Andelage. Et on est ici en fait parce que l'industrie des pharmaceutiques en ce moment semble être divisée. D'un côté, on voit les grandes entreprises comme vous, Pfizer, et de l'autre, le public, qui, à notre avis, devrait venir ensemble pour le bien des patients. On va aujourd'hui passer à travers notre modèle client. Donc, on commence par le contexte, en fait, pour voir c'est quoi le problème actuel, c'est quoi notre mandat en tant que consultant. On poursuit avec nos apprentissages, donc c'est vraiment le cœur de notre analyse, quels sont les éléments clés qui sont ressortis pour nous. On poursuit ensuite avec nos initiatives et l'exécution, qui est vraiment le cœur du sujet de notre présentation, qu'on a très hâte de vous présenter d'ailleurs. Puis, en même temps, on va vous parler un petit peu des chiffres, vous parler de budget et de revenus, puis finalement, on va conclure la présentation avec les éléments clés. Donc, pour commencer tout de suite avec le contexte, le problème que vous nous avez présenté, en fait, c'est que l'industrie globale des pharmaceutiques est sujette à beaucoup de critiques dans les dernières années, en raison particulièrement du fossé d'informations qui existe entre les entreprises et les parties prenantes, entre autres le grand public. Notre mandat, cet effet-là, a été de développer pour vous un plan stratégique et tactique qui va vous permettre d'aller vraiment améliorer votre réputation auprès du public, puis d'améliorer vos interactions avec l'ensemble des parties prenantes que nous avons considérées comme clés dans votre plan stratégique. Notre recommandation pour vous est d'utiliser votre position de leader dans l'industrie, justement, pour aller redéfinir la perception du public, son image de l'industrie des pharmaceutiques, en se basant sur trois priorités stratégiques, soit la collaboration avec les parties prenantes, l'éducation des parties prenantes et finalement vos interactions. Donc, on va commencer tout ça avec nos apprentissages et notre analyse. On a ciblé ou on a centré notre attention sur ces quatre parties prenantes-là principales, soit les professionnels de la santé, les associations de patients, les médias et le grand public et les patients. Les éléments clés à retenir pour les professionnels de la santé, en fait, c'est que c'est des prestataires de soins qui ont les mêmes valeurs que vous. Tout comme vous, ils sont dévoués aux patients, puis c'est vraiment leur priorité. Alors, c'est des gens avec qui vous voulez aller travailler, vous n'êtes pas en compétition. C'est une opportunité de collaboration pour vous. Au niveau des associations de patients, de façon similaire, eux aussi mettent les patients au cœur de leurs activités. C'est des groupes influents qui sont très bien perçus du public. Donc, c'est des gens avec qui vous voulez vous associer justement pour aller améliorer votre réputation parce que les gens les adorent déjà. Ensuite, on a les médias d'un autre côté qui, eux, ont également une influence qui est majeure. Ils ont une portée illimitée. Au sein du public, mais qui ont aussi vraiment le pouvoir catalyseur d'aller faire sortir les controverses puis d'aller vraiment nuire à la réputation si c'est mal géré. Un des avantages des médias aujourd'hui, par contre, c'est que vous pouvez en prendre contrôle, entre autres avec vos propres réseaux sociaux. Puis finalement, on a le grand public et les patients qui sont le centre de vos activités commerciales et qui sont parfois peu informés justement du fonctionnement de l'industrie, de pourquoi certaines choses sont comme elles le sont. Alors, c'est encore des gens que vous voulez aller vraiment éduquer et collaborer avec. Donc, ça, c'est des choses à retenir. Travailler avec les professionnels, avec les associations, aller prendre le contrôle des médias pour prendre le contrôle du message, puis finalement, aller éduquer le grand public. Je vais maintenant passer la parole à Rebecca qui va parler de l'environnement dans lequel vous travaillez.
The first thing we want to look at is what's working for Pfizer. So, we know that you are the world's leading research-based pharmaceutical company. And we also know that you have great existing CSR initiatives, which we'll touch on later on. And you are also centered around your patients, which is something that is really great and that we really look up to for. As for what needs work, we know that research and development for pharmaceutical companies is expensive, but that is something that we can't exactly control. We also know that your educational initiatives could use some work. And we would also like to work on the visibility of these CSR initiatives that I previously touched on. As for what to watch out for, we know that you work in a very highly regulated industry, and you do risk the loss of patents. And sometimes this industry can also have a negative connotation in the media, as Audrey touched on. So as for where to grow, we see that you can have an opportunity for growth in online presence, as well as your educational content. And philanthropy. So after touching on these opportunities, I'm going to pass it over to Audrey to do a gap analysis.
Donc comme on en a un peu déjà parlé dans notre analyse, en ce moment vous avez des initiatives de responsabilité sociale qui sont très bien, mais on voudrait qu'elles soient un peu plus visibles. Votre perception peut être négative à certains moments parce qu'elle l'est pour l'ensemble de l'industrie, donc c'est pas parce que vous faites quelque chose de mal, c'est parce que l'industrie dans son ensemble a besoin de travail, si on veut, avec le public, et finalement votre présence en ligne n'est pas aussi connectée qu'on voudrait l'avoir du public. Comment vous rendre à cet objectif-là qu'on a pour vous? En fait, c'est avec des partenariats stratégiques, avec les parties prenantes qu'on a mentionné plus tôt, avec du contenu éducatif en ligne qui est très accessible, et finalement avec des campagnes marketing dont Rebecca va parler plus tard. Donc, comme on le mentionne, on peut vraiment vous pousser à aller démontrer votre leadership dans l'industrie. C'est une opportunité pour vous en ce moment de montrer que vous êtes les premiers, vous êtes ceux qui accordent le plus d'importance aux patients, le plus d'importance au public, pour aller redéfinir l'image vraiment de l'industrie dans l'ensemble. Notre stratégie est basée sur trois piliers principaux, soit le développement des affaires, les affaires en ligne, et finalement le marketing et les relations publiques qui sont vraiment, vraiment le cœur de notre solution. Au niveau du développement des affaires, c'est à cet endroit-là qu'on va vraiment aller parler des partenariats auxquels on fait allusion depuis le début. Donc, on vous propose de lancer Pfizer Connect, qui est votre propre conférence annuelle que vous lanceriez. On vous propose de créer un comité à chaque année composé de chefs d'association de patients, par exemple, de chercheurs pharmaceutiques de votre compagnie, mais peut-être d'autres compagnies également, des prestataires de soins et finalement des invités spéciaux qui pourraient être, par exemple, des patients qui ont vécu une histoire avec les produits ou avec les traitements développés par Pfizer. La discussion au cours de cette conférence-là devrait être centrée vraiment sur l'importance de la recherche et de l'innovation dans votre domaine, des nouvelles percées à chaque année dans l'industrie et finalement de l'accessibilité des nouveaux traitements dans différentes régions. On vous propose aussi d'avoir des activités plus interactives, que ce soit des séances de formation, des kiosques d'échantillons, des discours d'invités spéciaux. Donc, c'est un peu une conférence typique, mais on veut qu'au lieu d'être juste le commanditaire, au lieu d'être juste la personne qui donne l'argent, que vous preniez le contrôle et que vous montriez que vous êtes prêt à mettre le temps et l'effort pour aller créer un lieu de rencontre pour les professionnels, pour les gens de l'industrie, puis que vous êtes prêt à aller vraiment payer pour aller donner du contenu informatif aux gens qui en ont besoin. Sur votre site web, ça pourrait ressembler à ça. Donc, tout simplement d'ajouter un onglet, faire Pfizer Connect à la fin, les gens paieraient probablement un certain frais, dépendamment de qui ils représentent, est-ce que c'est quelqu'un du public, est-ce que c'est un professionnel. Mais ça serait vraiment une belle opportunité à notre avis d'aller créer des alliances puis d'aller travailler ensemble pour redéfinir l'industrie pharmaceutique. Je vais maintenant passer la parole à Alamin qui va vous parler de notre prochain pilier.
To put into action a lot of the things we're talking about today, you need to ensure that your organization has the essential tools to ensure the feasibility. So I'm going to talk about IT and operations. First of all, there's a lot of enhancements that can happen across your organization with updated processes. We looked at your funnel for how long it takes for a drug to get out into the market, all the research and development behind it, and super important, if you want to enter into a reputable company with all the consumers that are coming with you and the suppliers that are coming with you, there are ways to deliver content better. And that is essentially what the core of the IT and operations are. So new tools to increase efficiency from project management and to ensure there's automation within how you deliver content. A lot of companies use MailChimp, for example, and Marketo. Those are all tools that bigger organizations use to keep up all the efficiency within it. And then analytics and BI collection. I'm going to dig into this a little bit further after, but measuring everything and actioning on it as you go on and revising your strategy. And we also looked at some of the numbers. So if you look at the healthcare providers communication study, it shows that there is an increasing growth for professionals to get a little bit more mobile friendly and digital content. Yes, of course, they're going to come to your sales staff, great people who come and deliver that kind of content. But if they have the ease of getting it into their email, which they've shown interest for, over 20% have shown that interest, as well as directly from the pharmaceutical products, it's gonna keep them engaged and get more people on it as they go on. And so one of the things that we also want to discuss is the fact that if we Google medical research, things like that, Pfizer doesn't come up exactly on the first page of Google. So if you take the investment and explore SEO opportunity to get the rankings higher, that could be a way people get more exposure into what Pfizer does and that research and development knowledge that you do want to disseminate across your networks. So if you take a look further, one of the other things I'm going to talk about is Pfizer Plus. This is a product we believe you can deliver that's going to aggregate all the news sources that you're already in touch with. All the latest research news in one place, delivered right to you, and it's going to go to the healthcare professionals. So if we take a look into the next topic, it's going to be about breaking down the types of areas you're going to cover. So we believe that it's best for you to start off with these topics that you already specialize in, from biosimilars to inflammation to immunology. And we think a base price of $200 a year for a specific topic is a great way to start off. There's 38,000 physicians across Canada, it's growing, and if you can secure a percentage of that, get them on board with topics that matter to them, keep them engaged, and give them all the information that's unbiased, because essentially what you're doing as Pfizer is aggregating news sources as well as putting your own news sources within these topics. And this is something that is gonna continue to engage them and give value to them, because they want to be informed with the latest research possible. We also included an option where you can have Pfizer Plus Unlimited for $1,000 a year. And later on in the numbers, I'll discuss exactly how this plays out over the next 5 years. I'm gonna pass it off to Rebecca to talk about the marketing public relations aspect.
So we came up with three main topics for you to market to your consumers. So the first, these are gonna be a series of videos that are going to go out on your social media platforms, Facebook and Instagram. We noticed that you're lacking a bit on Instagram, so we'd like to push that a bit more. We know you have 300 plus followers on Facebook, but only around 8,000 on Instagram, and Instagram is continually growing, especially with videos. So this first one, a look back, is going to focus on Pfizer's roots. We want to get the message out that you are a great company and you strive for your clients' best interests. And so this is going to touch on the history of Pfizer. We know you started from small roots, from two cousins who started as friends playing. We'd like to have a video go out to showcase this and showcase how your company started from small, humble beginnings. And hopefully this can allow the public to relate to you more instead of seeing you as a giant corporation. The next idea is for a Healthier You campaign. This is going to showcase true client stories, and it's going to demonstrate the value of these medications that you offer to these clients and allow the public to see the real difference that you make for your clients. And then lastly, we have the We Care. So this is going to showcase your corporate philanthropy that Audrey and I have mentioned in the past, and we want to showcase more. We know that you have your volunteer days for your staff, and you also help out with the Paralympics. So this is something that we want to showcase on social media to allow the public to see how these big giant pharmaceutical companies are really doing their best to help. And these philanthropic initiatives would be great to showcase on your social media because of this. And we really think that this is going to introduce a brand personality for you. And in the end, it's going to give a great impression of you to the public. This is an example of a video that you put out that did very well. As you can see, it has over 3 million views. So this is essentially what we want to do for you. We want you to put out these videos onto social media and gain even more interaction with your consumers. So this is an example of these three campaigns that I mentioned on your Instagram account and how it would showcase.
Donc pour un peu revenir sur la stratégie, évidemment, c'est une stratégie qui est vraiment beaucoup basée sur des nouvelles initiatives marketing. Et on veut aussi vous démontrer qu'il peut y avoir des indicateurs de performance à long terme pour vous prouver que ça a été efficace. Donc sur 5 ans, on croit vraiment fermement que ça va vous permettre de vous réduire beaucoup en fait de livraison de contenu informatif. Pourquoi? Parce qu'en ce moment, cette livraison est essentiellement assurée par vos représentants des ventes. Qui vont aller voir directement les professionnels de santé, alors qu'en faisant cette transition-là vers beaucoup plus de contenu en ligne, beaucoup plus accessible, on sait que du contenu en ligne est beaucoup plus abordable à livrer pour une entreprise, donc on pense que vous allez être capable de potentiellement même diminuer votre force ou votre base de représentants des ventes à long terme en transférant plus de cette fonction-là, si on veut, livraison de contenu informatif en ligne. Deuxièmement, on aimerait que la plateforme Pfizer Plus, dont Alan a parlé, que vous allez chercher 20% des professionnels canadiens, professionnels qui utilisent la plateforme au bout de 5 ans. C'est quand même ambitieux, on sait que c'est beaucoup, beaucoup de professionnels, mais on pense que ça se fait bien, vous avez déjà une grande renommée. Tous les professionnels de santé au Canada connaissent déjà votre entreprise, donc avec le bon marketing, avec les bons efforts, on pense que vous pouvez aller chercher ces 20%-là. Puis finalement, on aimerait aller chercher une augmentation de 60% de votre présence en ligne, entre autres avec la livraison de contenu plus interactif, plus éducatif, mais aussi avec les campagnes de marketing, évidemment, dont Rebecca a parlé précédemment, puis en allant vraiment chercher plus d'interactions avec le public, avec les parties prenantes dont on parle depuis le début. Donc, j'aimerais maintenant passer la parole à Armin, qui va vraiment vous parler de comment tout ça se passe au niveau de l'exécution sur les 5 prochaines années.
We talked a lot about strategies, and we give you a lot of ideas today, but how's it going to get into action? So I'm going to talk about the execution. So first off, it's going to start with the short-term phase, which is going to go up to a year. We broke it down into Gantt chart by first half of 2018, second half of 2018, and the years go on. So the first year is going to be diagnosing. You're looking into the planning aspects, seeing how all this is going to play out for the years to come. And so creating the strategic plan with the executive management is a top priority. Have to make sure that everything lines up. Finalizing the budgets that's going to be proposed. If there needs to be cuts made in priorities, that all needs to be made straightforward. If that involves dropping the conference, for example, those are risks that are going to have to be looked into. Setting up the project management team, there's a lot of work that's being put into this, and if you divide up within Pfizer's internal team to have project management teams to lead this, this is going to be playing well from 2018 and the years to follow to ensure long-term sustainability. And then also launching the partnership reach out. Just like Audrey was mentioning, you have to be connecting with these industry professionals that you already have good networks with. But to bring these people forward and have them pursue the transparency that you as an organization are trying to lead within this country is going to be huge and crucial. Selecting the contractors from video production to the graphic and collateral, and aggregating the research for reporting. Like we were talking about before, Pfizer Plus is going to be a source for all the news and latest research that a lot of your consumers and stakeholders want to see. And so that's going to be put into action right in the first year. Launch your recruitment campaign from the people that are going to join the board for transparency across Canada, as well as your own team itself to help lead the Pfizer Plus initiative, for example, and the events itself and social media. And then drafting those foundational documents, setting a mandate for how exactly you want to release the transparency to the general public, going about it in a way that's going to be long-term and sustainable, and how you can collaborate with all these different companies that also want to do the same within the pharmaceutical industry. Next, we're going to look at the meat, which is treating. So you take your client, you treat them, it takes a lot of work, you've done everything, and this is where there is a lot of action taking place. It's going to be launching those campaigns. As you can see, we set it up to be iterative, and based on those campaigns, it'll be growing a lot of buzz on social media so that everybody can see what Pfizer's doing and what it's all about. Sharing these client stories and making sure, like you already have on YouTube, Meet Dave, all these YouTube videos that don't have enough views yet, but you put them out on Facebook, you put them out on Instagram, you put them out on YouTube, it's going to start growing some integrated marketing communications, and you'll be able to get more reach that way. And then distributing a quarterly white paper. We saw that you have a white guide. It's for your US non-sales reps, and that's something that we think you can make it a little bit condensed and release out onto email delivery for the people who are gonna sign up for Pfizer Plus, for example. And so having some of those white papers to the specific topics that I mentioned before would be fantastic for those professionals who look to Pfizer for the leading research that they give. Distributing the collateral to the sales teams, of course, again, 51% of the study for healthcare professionals, communication, prefer it to come from the sales team of the pharmaceutical companies. And so you're going to give them the marketing collateral they need to equip them so that they can keep doing their job as efficiently as possible. And then the rest follow from operating and operational efficiency, finalizing the tools, enhancing the ERP, things like that across your organization that are going to take a little bit of big change. And then launching Pfizer Plus will happen right at the beginning of 2019, and I'll show you again in the revenues how exactly this translates for the years to come. Creating a feedback mechanism, because you need to see how people are reacting to this. These healthcare professionals, again, that are looking to Pfizer for all the latest scoop in research in pharmaceuticals, they need to give you feedback that you can action out. And then finalizing mobile application. So this is something that we saw that you already have one that's targeted towards customers. So the RX pathways, that's one product that you have that customers can do self-serve with. So if you have an application that links to Pfizer Plus, for example, with your internal team, you have such strong resources, we believe that this will make an impact and make it even more easier for professionals to come and use these mobile-friendly applications. And then the final phase is going to be within the last stretch of the 5 years, which is going to be building a BI and analytics dashboard to measure how all of this is translating to your performance, assess the feedback and revise the systems, like I was mentioning before, seeing how you can improve the delivery of the content, seeing how you can go about a way of advertising differently across social media, and fine-tuning all that. New product plans, obviously, in the works, and other engagement initiatives. If you keep these healthcare professionals engaged, they're going to be there for life. They're going to look at you as a credible source for everything pharmaceutical research related. So, talking about all that, I'm going to jump into the numbers. So first off is the expense breakdown. As you can see, the biggest cost here is going to be the IT costs, and that makes sense, of course, because of how it's broken down. Actually, it's the marketing costs, and that's because of all the advertising spending you're going to do. With that, the operations cost comes after, and then the IT cost, which comes out to just under $6 million in spend over the 5 years. Next up, we're going to look at the revenues. So the way I broke it down is we took a percentage of the 38,000 positions across Canada, and we factored in how you would monetize it with the $200 per subscription per year, and then the $1,000 subscription per year. And what we did after that is we set an average growth rate of 8%. And over the 5 years, it comes out to a little over $11 million in revenue that we projected. And when we ran our sensitivity analysis, it made sense. We put it at 85% rate for the pessimistic and increased 50% for the optimistic. At the end of the 5 years, this is going to come down to a return on investment of 87%. And one thing I'm going to point out is in 2018, you'll see $0 in revenue pertaining to the strategy because at this point, Pfizer Plus is in development, not released yet.
Quand même maintenant, faire un petit retour sur la présentation d'aujourd'hui. On sait qu'on vous a présenté beaucoup d'informations. En fait, les trois choses qu'on veut vraiment vous retenir, c'est que vous avez un grand nombre de participants avec lesquels travailler, mais la majorité d'entre elles ne sont pas des compétiteurs. C'est des gens qui ont les mêmes objectifs, qui ont les mêmes valeurs, puis avec qui vous pouvez collaborer pour aller améliorer vraiment non seulement votre réputation, mais la réputation de l'industrie dans laquelle vous travaillez en général. Donc, travailler avec ces groupes-là, que ce soit les associations de patients, que ce soit les professionnels de la santé, les prestataires de services, c'est des gens qu'on veut qui vous aiment puis que nous savons qu'ils peuvent vous aider vraiment à aller améliorer votre réputation. D'un autre côté, on veut aussi que vous soyez un leader en termes de contenu éducatif engageant, tant pour les professionnels de la santé, entre autres avec Pfizer Plus, mais aussi pour les citoyens intéressés, que ce soit avec le contenu marketing en ligne, mais aussi avec la transparence dans l'ensemble de vos activités d'affaires. On veut que vous démontriez justement au grand public que vous n'êtes pas là pour cacher quoi que ce soit, mais que vous êtes prêt à leur expliquer comment l'industrie fonctionne, puis comment vous pouvez travailler ensemble finalement pour aller aider les patients. Puis finalement, tout ça va vous aider à partager votre identité, à montrer qui vous êtes comme entreprise, des deux cousins qui ont commencé quand ils étaient jeunes, aux milliers et millions de vies que vous avez influencées avec les traitements que vous avez innovés finalement. Ça a été vraiment un plaisir d'être avec vous aujourd'hui. Je vais vous inviter à poser des questions si vous en avez, puis ça va nous faire un plaisir de vous répondre.
Well done, congratulations. Honestly, I think you've given the amount of time and the time of the morning, early hours that you looked at that, you really have done a great job from a consumer, from a public, and even from a healthcare professional perspective. The question that I would ask is, did you have any thoughts, or did you give any thoughts to the aspect of whether like government or private payers play and how we could work with them, because ultimately they're the ones who make the decisions as to which products are prescribed to patients.
Oh, of course, and Audrey touched on that with the whole conference, getting people together. And with private payers, these are insurance companies, it doesn't work for the branded medicine, for example. It works with when the generic medicine comes out, right? And working with them is crucial, and we took that into consideration and how we collaborate with it. When I went on to the first phase and talking about these partnership reach outs, that's exactly what it was for. Reach out to private payers, the provincial governments across Canada, and to ensure that there is synergies that they can collaborate on to ensure the recurring transparency and delivery of content with pharmaceutical research across Canada. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. So just for clarity, this conference that you're recommending is an annual conference where you invite all stakeholders.
Yeah, of course.
So you're saying private payers, like prescribers, patient associations.
Yes.
Okay.
First of all, thank you for the comprehensive presentation. It was very interesting. You guys have a lot of stuff on the go. My question for you is more, I believe, on the Pfizer Plus portion. So you chose to try and monetize that tactic, right?
Yeah.
Had you given any thought to the risks of having a paywall, which could potentially minimize the benefit to the positive reputation you're trying to change?
Yeah, of course. So it's all about the timing with it, right? And there's a lot of open information that's going to go out from Pfizer out to the general public and healthcare professionals. Having a Plus subscription gives you an aggregated source for that. I'll give you an example. There's an agriculture technology company called FarmLead that has specific subscriptions for different crops that they use. And farmers all across Canada and the United States are going to sign up for just corn, for example, so they know how to better grow their corn and sell it. This is the same play that we think you can consider. Already having information on the different topics that you discuss within Pfizer's research is great, and it's going to continue. But having that Plus subscription available to people who really benefit from it, we see that there is value to that because they're going to get it right to their app, they're going to get it right to their email, they're going to get it in every single way possible, and it's aggregating all the top journals and publications and research universities that work with Pfizer to deliver that content.
Thank you.
Okay. Félicitations. Beau travail, messieurs, dames. Very well done. My question is related to one of the things that you've talked about, the consumer aspect of it. I mean, and my question is more related to you as consumers. So how much did you know about Pfizer, and what was your perception of Pfizer prior being the case, and what has changed following the work you've done related to Pfizer?
I think we can all talk about that, if that's fine. But for me, for example, Pfizer's a big company, and I've always seen it as like a big giant, and it's, you know, I've always known it's like the big name, like You know, when I had roommates at university, they were like, oh, like invest in their stock, this is a good one, it's gonna keep going up, you know, because it was leading edge. And after reading this, there's so much cool information that I didn't know, you know. For example, how closely you work with just like the actual provincial governments and the payer groups, and ensuring that everything can be as transparent as possible. Like you were saying, a lot of the people don't even know that revenues generated from the branded medicine goes right back to the R&D. I didn't know that, and you know, it's eye-opening. It's really cool to see that Pfizer does like care about, you know, advancing the human health, and it's a patient-centric company, and that is very formidable.
Millie, as Alman said, I never really had looked into your philanthropic side, obviously, and seeing that side on your website and in the case as well really opened my eyes to show me that you're not just a corporate giant, like I mentioned in the presentation, that your mandate is that you want to help people. So I thought that was really humbling and interesting.
I think I had a similar perspective. I've worked kind of in banking in the past few years, and I think banking kind of has that same sort of persona around it, where people think, you know, the big five are deserve to make money. And I was working in community relations and events, so it was really cool to see the other aspect of banking, where it's like we're giving money to the communities and we're working with our communities. So seeing that parallel with your medical company or pharmaceutical company was really cool as well, and I think I saw a lot of resemblance between the two.
Okay, thanks. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.